Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be looking at Chapter 6 of Pragmatic Programmer, which is called Concurrency. This is one of the shorter chapters of the book, but still pretty meaty in terms of content. Concurrency is like parallelism, but slightly different in the sense that parallelism is when two or more pieces of code run at the same time, whereas concurrency is when two or more pieces of code act like they run at the same time, but are not actually. We'll be looking at both of those in this chapter. How programs operate in the real world reflects the fact that things are happening simultaneously all the time, and thus software has to be designed in a way that is compatible with that aspect of operation. If a website, for example, can only handle requests sequentially, then there can only be one user at a time, which wouldn't make for a viable business at all. Unfortunately, our brains think sequentially, and thus there's a danger for what we create to be at odds with how the product would be used in the real world. The first section of the chapter is called Breaking Temporal Coupling, and it talks about timing in software. Usually, when we think about time, we're mostly considering how long a program will take to create, but less often the aspects of concurrency or the order things happen when they aren't concurrent. We tend to think of operations happening in a certain order, such as how a user flows through an experience on a website, or how a background job processes its tasks, and so on. Usage is hard to predict the more flexible a software is, and so the possible solutions for predicting usage are either to make software less flexible in its usage or to spend more time and effort intentionally planning. The authors suggest the latter approach, and to look for instances where concurrency happens in the upcoming software's usage. They call a map of the activities that can or will happen at the same time an activity diagram, which is made up of actions noted as round boxes. These boxes can be placed sequentially or next to each other to signify happening at the same time or happening after a previous action. Laying everything out like this will make sure that everything that can happen simultaneously will, and actions further down the sequence won't happen until all their dependencies are resolved. By extension, when we see actions that aren't dependent on each other, we've discovered an opportunity for concurrency. So, writing with concurrency in mind happens at the software level, and parallelism is a hardware matter. Some languages, such as Elixir, do this automatically for you when it compiles, and it ends up being able to run tasks substantially faster than other similar languages like Ruby. The next section is called Shared State is Incorrect State, and it starts with an analogy of you or a customer eating at a diner, asking for the last piece of pie at the same time that another patron does. The pie may be available when you ask, but if the server isn't fast enough, another waiter might beat him to serving it to the other customer, leaving you or that customer in this example without the dessert you want. The authors introduce a concept called semaphores, which means a thing that only one person can use at a time. Thus, the pie piece would become a semaphore when the first waiter looks at it, so that a second waiter would be unable to see it and think that it, meaning that piece of pie, might be available to be taken. The authors go on about this concept for a while, but essentially what you need to understand in tandem with the semaphore is that where those exist, you need to have a locking and unlocking mechanism to ensure that no activities are allowed when they shouldn't be. In the case of the pie analogy, we could say a disallowed action is that a second waiter telling a customer that the piece of pie is available when the first waiter was about to serve that last piece to his customer is that disallowed action. So the solution, or the locking mechanism, would be something along the lines of when a waiter, the first waiter in this case, sees a slice of pie, he locks the pie fridge, and when the second waiter sees that the fridge is locked, he'll see that the slice is accounted for. Then, when the first waiter hears from the customer that he wants to order the pie, the waiter can confidently go back and collect the pie to be served. That system also spares the second waiter from making an embarrassing mistake, like telling the customer incorrect information about pie availability, or getting into a fight with his teammate about who gets the last slice. The next section is called actors and processes. These concepts are pretty in the weeds, but we'll get through them together. Actor is a term that, in the computer science context, means an independent virtual processor that is able to receive and send messages, update state machines, and so on. A process is similar, but is more generalized and is usually implemented by an operating system to behave like actors. To give the actor concept a more concrete image, the authors again turn to the waiter fetching a slice of pie example. So an actor, in this case the waiter, asks if a customer is hungry, yes or no. But if yes, then he, meaning the customer, asks for the pie. The actor goes to check if there is pie in stock, yes or no. But if yes, then the pie will be dispensed and the cost of the pie will be added to the bill. If no, then apologize to the customer and no further actions will happen, except perhaps taking a different order from the customer and starting that sequence again. So that's all for this video. My name is Daniel, and I make programming related videos, sometimes coding tutorials and other more abstract ones like book chapter summaries. I do it not only because I love teaching you, but I love teaching for myself. I love learning for myself as well. So if you found this video and this series helpful or thought-provoking, I'd appreciate a like, subscribe, comment, etc. I love hearing from you, and we'll see you in the next one.